There are a few moments in our lives where everything stands still. Some of you might have experienced this with the recent solar eclipse, fleeting moments of literal darkness and stillness, punctuated, at least in my experience, by the contagious joy of the people around you. Or a bit closer to Earth, maybe it's the first breath of a newborn family member, when you realize just how tiny babies are. These moments put us as humans into perspective, maybe with how brief our lives here are or how small we are on the grand scales of the cosmos. For astronomers, and I think for many of us to some extent, these moments of perspective also probe the deepest questions of our existence. Where did we come from? Are we alone in the universe? What happened at the very beginning? And perhaps more distant, what will happen at the very end? For my colleagues and I at the North American Nanohertz Observatory for Gravitational Waves, which I'm aware is a mouthful, so I'll refer to us as NanoGrav from now on. June 29th, 2023 was perhaps one of the most significant standstill moments of our careers. On June 29th, we announced the detection of significant evidence for a gravitational wave background permeating our universe, like the ripples of raindrops on still water, found literally in between the signals of dozens of distant stars that we monitored for years. Even though we had seen these results several months earlier, watching the world stop and take notice was electric. Today, I want to share with you all a glimpse of that work, because in my very unbiased opinion, it is one of the most emblematic scientific experiments of recent history and encapsulates so much of the human experience that I think many of us don't necessarily call to mind when we think of astrophysics. To understand how low-frequency gravitational waves, the overlapping signals of which constitute this gravitational wave background, can be detected, we need to go over just a bit of history. The existence of ultra-long gravitational waves was kind of implicit when Einstein developed his theory of general relativity, which is a universal description of the interactions of gravity. We have this united fabric of space-time, and there can be ripples in it, the same way that you might have ripples in a sheet. But it wasn't until the late 1970s that the path to detecting such long gravitational waves was proposed. I mean, to find gravitational waves the size of a galaxy, you need a detector of at least similar size. And that was just kind of out of the question when we had only recently managed to make it to the moon. But about a decade earlier, a peculiar type of astronomical object was discovered by a graduate student at Cambridge named Jocelyn Bell Burnell. These stars spin so fast that their rotation creates these jets of emission at their magnetic poles. And when they are aligned with the Earth, we see these little blips of increased emission at really regular intervals, similar to how a lighthouse appears to flash from far away. Astronomers are notoriously very good at naming things. Examples include the Very Large Telescope, which is exactly what it sounds like. So we call these stars pulsars because they look like they're pulsing. Now, these intervals are so regular that they were soon timed to high precision, creating an exact account of when a pulse from a particular source to a particular observatory would arrive, given the constant speed of light and the distances between us and the stars, down to millionths of a second of accuracy. This is really hard to do. Now, you might see where I'm going with this now. If gravitational waves stretch and compress space-time, then the distances between us and a distant star change ever so slightly. And if we can create a timing model that predicts those pulses down to millions of a second using those distances, we will also find changes in the residuals of these pulse arrival times, the differences between what we expect a pulse to arrive at versus what it actually does. And this is exactly what was proposed in Steven Detweiler's 1979 paper, and now it's 2024. And we've finally built up enough of a baseline in our pulsar timing array to find significant evidence for a gravitational wave background. NanoGrav's most recent data release includes 15 years of timing data and over 500,000 pulses observed and modeled across 68 pulsars, because we can't just use one to find gravitational waves. That would take even longer. We need an array of these sources in all different directions of the sky. Because if we find correlations in the residuals of pairs of pulsars at different angular separations, and pulses from sources in these directions appear to be arriving a little later than they should, whereas pulses from sources in these directions are arriving a little earlier, well, that implies the same cross-stretching and compressing characteristic of these gravitational waves. So our data set has to be huge, and it already is. And we're incredibly excited to see what the future holds when we combine our data with that of our colleagues at the International Pulsar Timing Array, which includes four member collaborations, also NanoGrav, and a further two associate collaborations, utilizing telescopes and personnel from across the globe. Now, I personally could go on for hours and hours about the scientific implications of our results, but I think more notably for those of us who aren't scientists by trade is the fact that these results flowed from years of labor driven by largely one thing, the belief that this work is worth doing. The challenge of detecting something that we don't know is detectable is not a small one. While we have generated more funding in recent years as our results have built in significance, so much of this work was done outside of paid work hours, or by graduate students who have long since left the field, or in the incremental contributions of many an undergraduate summer project. It is hard to continue pushing on a project that you don't know will come to fruition. As satisfying as it was to release our 5, 9, 11, 12 and a half, and now 15-year data sets, the continuing dedication to time these pulses and quantify these microscopic deviations from our meticulously built and maintained timing models comes from something much deeper than the simple drive to publish or perish. And I think in general, astrophysics is one of those fields that we mistake as having little application to our lives as individuals. There's no obvious social utility in detecting a gravitational wave background so faint that it takes decades of data to uncover. I don't feel the world around me stretching and compressing, although it would definitely be nice if the distance to work was a little shorter sometimes. But these gravitational waves are the footprints of hundreds of individual sources across both time and space. We might see echoes of the density fluctuations from the earliest moments of our universe, or the cacophony of active supermassive black holes in our current universe. The fun part, at least for astronomers, is that we don't know yet. What we do know, and what we found in all sorts of fields within astrophysics, is that this gravitational wave background isn't some far-off phenomenon. Whatever we find in that background will cascade into our knowledge of the nearby. Now that we're listening, like the hum of conversation in a cafe, we may just be able to pick out a voice. And if we focus our efforts on understanding that one voice, we may be able to characterize that source. Maybe it's a black hole at the center of a far-off galaxy, and we can determine the mass of that black hole. Well, that gives us information about the size of the galaxy that it holds together, which can tell us maybe how many stars are in that galaxy. And if we know how many stars are in that galaxy, we can take a guess at the number of planetary systems, and further, habitable planets, based on our understanding of the distribution of planets in a given galaxy. And one day, if we point one of our fancy next-generation telescopes at one of those stars, we might just catch a planet crossing in front of it, which could tell us information about its atmosphere. And suddenly we can answer questions like, is there water? What about oxygen? Where did we come from? And is it possible that there are others like us? One of the most common questions I get during outreach talks is how far we are from some benchmark of progress. How far are we from sending people to Mars? Or how far are we from interstellar travel? You'll notice that most of these questions assume our future ability to do something or to go somewhere. But in my experience, similar questions of discovery don't make the same assumptions. For example, have we found evidence of alien life? Or do you believe in string theory? Or even, will we ever figure out how the Big Bang happened? Now, scientifically, this is pretty rigorous, right? We make questions based on what we know in the past to be true, and then we state our future understanding probabilities based on what we know right now. But I do sometimes worry that this undermines the most significant precursor to progress. Knowing what to do now, as in right now, to enable that future understanding. Not many people question if we will ever get to Mars, or even if we will ever build a rocket economical enough to take us beyond the solar system. And it's that belief that will take tomorrow's engineers and astronauts to the finish line. If there's anything I've learned as a member of NanoGrav, it's that our capacity for discovery begins with the belief that we will discover. our innate human curiosity and wonder are worth following and nourishing. And the greatest discoveries about who we are and why we're here have come from that wonder. Whether it's recognizing that in 500 million years, the human species won't experience solar eclipses anymore, or realizing that your newborn cousin will never be that small again, there are so many things about our experience on this earth that are incredibly time sensitive. We don't have time to wonder if we will ever touch the stars. We need to first trust that we will. And it doesn't take an astrophysicist to notice how many other things that applies to. Thank you.